Dr. J. I think now we can actually go into your presentation, please.
Let's do that.
I wanted to lecture us on the topic of the day.
Okay, I'm going to go ahead and open up my PowerPoint here that I prepared for you. Of course, okay. I'm Founder Center of Apologetics. That's who I am. That's what I represent. So it'll be me. It'll be my PowerPoint that you will see, be seeing here. And I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to talk about this whole problem of what are we going to do with Mecca, the problems with Mecca. And there are myriad of problems of with Mecca. By the way, happy Valentine's Day to anybody who's out there, including my wife, if she's listening. Happy Valentine's Day. I will give her a special Valentine's greeting once this program is finished, because it's still early in the morning here in the East Coast. So why are we having this historical critique? What is its value? What is the purpose of asking these kind of questions? Well, one of the great things about it is what I'm doing today, and I do this all the time, and that's why in most of my talks, I do historical talks. The value of the historical critique is what we're doing today, is that it confronts the very foundations of Islam. It confronts the book and it confronts the man. This especially confronts the book. The man would be the traditions, and it confronts the traditions as well. What we're going to do today really does confront everything we know about Islam. The great thing about, though, this question that I'm asking, it is neutral. You notice this is a neutral question. Anybody can ask the question I'm asking today. This is not a Christian polemic. This has nothing to do with Christianity confronting Islam. We're not as Christians confronting Islam. I'm a historian confronting Islam. So this is politically correct. I am not attacking Muslims. Please, Muslim, if you're listening to me, I'm not here to attack you. I'm not going to say anything about you. All I'm going to say is Muslims in plural have a problem with their history. That's not attacking you. That is a conclusion I've come to after doing these studies. And you're going to see that Muslims, you do have a problem with your history. But I'm not sitting there. My intention is not to attack anybody. All right. Therefore, do not assume that what I'm going to be doing today is hate speech. This has nothing to do with hatred. Okay. This has nothing. I'm not Islamophobic for asking this question. It's ironic. Whenever I question Islam, the first thing that comes back is you're a hate preacher. Mm. You're an Islamophobe. And I said, what's phobic about what I'm asking? Listen, this has been asked of Christianity for centuries. Yeah. Remember I talked about it, Korede? I said to Wellhausen asked this question a good back in the 1800s, coming up to almost to two centuries ago. And he was never called a hate preacher for asking this question. There's no such word as Christianophobe. That doesn't even exist, because it'd be stupid to say that. And in some ways, I wish Muslims would stop saying, because they look stupid when they say that. They look absolutely idiotic when they call us an Islamophobe for asking historical questions about the Quran and about their history. So the other thing you're going to find, that's one reason I'm using a PowerPoint. It's very easy to communicate. It's so visual. You'll see what I'm saying, as you shall so soon see. And also, if this is a problem for Islam, if Islam has a problem with Mecca, then I, as a Christian, the only one that really has an answer for them. If you have a problem with your Quran, if your Quran is full of historical anachronism, as we're going to show today, then where do you think you need to come home to? You need to come home to us, because we don't have this problem. Amen. We have had everything. Almost every question has been thrown at Christianity. Every question, from the historical questions to the theological questions to the social mandate to the whole scientific problems of the Bible, they have, listen, we've had it, and we've answered every question. So the more we find with concerning problems in your Quran and your traditions, listen, folks, listen, Muslims, just come on home. Come on home to the Bible.
Amen.
Because these problems don't exist for us. All right, so let's get right into it. Let's go ahead and let's talk about the geographical. Let's start, number one, with the geographical problems with Mecca. And we're going to talk about the north versus south, the Nabataean north versus the Meccan south. And when you open up the Quran, you will find that it has 65 geographical references. But only nine places are named, mostly referring to people. The most common are the three that I have here on the left. The name Ud comes up 23 times. These people from Ud, Well, we know that Ud is the biblical Uz. That's also in the Bible. So we're very familiar with the people from Ud. Or in Arabic would be Ud. For Hebrew, it would be Uz. The people from Thamud. There's the Arabic or the Nabataean name, Thamud. These are known as the Nabataeans. We know them as Nabataeans in the Bible. Also, historically, they are known as the Nabataeans. You will find that these people from Thamud are referred to 24 times in the Quran. 23 times for Ud, 24 times for the Nabataean. The Nabataeans, these people from Thamud, are the great rock engravers. They cut out entire cities out of rock, and their dwellings, their temples, their burials, their tombs are all cut straight out of the rock. And if you go to a place like Petra today, you will see that's the greatest of the Nabataean, of the people from Thamud. That is the greatest of their cities. Beautiful. One of the great wonders of the world. And then seven times you have references to these people from Midian, known as the Midianites. Now, if these people from these places are mentioned that many times, they must be pretty important to whoever the Quran's writing about. And the Quran is always referring to these three civilizations that the representative of God. Now, who is the representative? Well, Muslims will say that's Muhammad. The problem is Muhammad is only referred to four times in the Quran. Only four times. Let me give you the references. I've got them right here. He's referred to in chapter 3, verse 144, in chapter 33, verse 40, in chapter 47, verse 2, and in chapter 48, verse 29. That's it. You're not going to see Muhammad's name anywhere else in the Quran except for those four verses. And those four verses say nothing about Mecca or where or anything about where he lived. So all the other times that you hear references to the Nabi, the Rasul, the representative of God, the prophet of God, it's not Muhammad's name. It's just nebulous. It is absolutely neutral. Muslims, therefore, have to come and put in English in parentheses, Muhammad, 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 Muhammad. That's what Muslims have done today. They put Muhammad's name in there in all those places to say, this is Muhammad, this is Muhammad. Who knows? How do they know it's Muhammad? Because his name's not there, suggesting that he's not very important either to the Quran. Ironically, Jesus's name, Issa, is all through the Quran. About 93 times you will find Jesus's name in the Arabic, not in parentheses, in the Arabic. Moses's name, Abraham's name, their names are replete, and they are found many more times than Muhammad, because he's only found four times. So here's a problem. If this prophet or this Nabi or this person has having contact with these people from Ad, from Thamud and Midian, 23 times from Ad, 24 times from Thamud, 7 times from Midian, it suggests to me that this person is pretty close to where these people are, right? If he's having daily contact with them, they must be pretty close by, right? Well, look at the map on the right.
Yeah.
Look where Ad is, look where Thamud is, look where Midian is, and then look where Mecca is. Mecca is right at the bottom. These people are all living 600 miles farther north. 600 miles. Ooh, Well, how do you have contact with people 600 miles away unless you had a helicopter to go up there and back 1,200 miles in a day? There's no way in the world he could go out and having reached conversations with these people from way up north all the time, and yet they are living 600 miles away, unless, of course, you lived up there yourself. Hold on to that. Hold on to that, okay? So there's the first problem, the geographical problems. Now, let's just do a comparison, because Muslims are always saying, well, you got the same problem with the Bible. No, we do not. No, we do not. And I'm going to show you right now, just look at the Quran and compare it with the Gospel of Luke. I'm just going to use the Gospel of Luke because Luke is the best one when it comes to geography, because Luke was a doctor. He used geographical locations. He talked about places. He talked about settlements, cities, places, countries, you name it. He talked about it. And there are 110 geographical references in the Gospel of Luke alone. Now, the Gospel of Luke is much, 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 much smaller than the Quran. It's just one gospel. The Quran, much, much, much bigger, only refers to 65 geographical references. So you can see there are lots more for the Gospel of Luke to go wrong with, right? 31 places are named in the Gospel of Luke. Only 9 places are named in the Quran. So only 9 places in the Quran. You would think, therefore, those 9 places are correct. You correct? Only 9 that they have to defend. Yeah. We have to defend 31. In every one of those 9 places, the Quran is incorrect. I don't have time to go through all 9 of them. I'm just going to do with Mecca. Because Mecca is only found once in the entire Quran. You can see the significance of what I'm talking about. Mecca is only referred to one time in the Quran. Now, in the 31 places in the Gospel of Luke, every one of those places is correct. We cannot find one problem with one city, one reference of the 31 references. Not one is incorrect. They are all in the right place. In the case of the Quran, every one of those 9 places and those geographical references is incorrect. Wrong place, wrong time, wrong period.